morning, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started. A copy of the Open Meetings Act is located on the north wall of the legislative chambers. An automatic external defibrillator is available on the wall of the legislative chamber, back wall of the legislative chambers. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
With that, we will begin with the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Equalization. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle.
Here.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Here.
Commissioner Duda.
Here.
Commissioner Kraft.
Here.
Commissioner Morgan.
Here.
Commissioner Rogers. Madam Chair.
Here. Item A, approval of the minutes of the Board of Equalization meeting held Tuesday, September 27th, 2016. And item B, call for a meeting and set Tuesday, October 11th, 2016. Please note on the agenda that it says 2017, but it should say 2016. As a date for hearing on certified assessment corrections, reflecting the addition of omitted property to the tax rolls or increased value on property. Is there a motion to approve?
Second.
A and B?
Yes. Yes.
Motion by Boyle, second by Morgan. Please vote.
Motion passes.
Citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the Board of Equalization about an item not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to resolutions. There are resolutions items D through H. Is there a motion to approve? Does that include adjournment?
Yes.
And the second? Okay.
Yes.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
We'll move to the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Commissioners. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle.
Here.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Here.
Commissioner Duda.
Here.
Commissioner Kraft.
Here.
Mr. Morgan.
Here.
Commissioner Rogers.
Here.
Madam Chair.
Here. Item A, approval of the minutes of the Board of Commissioners meeting held Tuesday, September 27, 2016. And item B, approval of claims submitted for payment processed through Tuesday, October 4, 2016. Is there a motion to approve A and B?
So moved. Second.
Any questions or comments? Motion by Morgan, seconded by Kraft. Please vote.
Motion passes.
Consent agenda items A through L. Is there a motion to approve? Motion by Boyle, seconded by Rogers. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
I just have a quick question on some appointments here to the County Fair Board. I'm glad to see that we're filling
some vacancies. But if anyone knows, there's a reappointment of Mr. Eddie Bywer, and I just would like to know how long Mr. Bywer has served on the County Fair Board, if anybody knows.
I just looked at that.
He's probably the senior member. Okay. I would guess him
to be the senior member of the board. He's also on the Nebraska State Fair Board. This guy is kind of, his hobby is fairs. He travels around the country going to fairs all over the place. And we're lucky to have somebody like that willing to volunteer to help us.
Yes, I'm familiar with him from going to the meetings, and he does a great job, and hats off to him. I just, kind of keeping track of these in terms of how many years they served. I know how sensitive Commissioner Morgan is to term limits, and so I'm trying to keep track of that for you, PJ. But we have two new appointees, is that correct? And, that's great. This is the young blood, new blood that we look forward to, and I know that it wasn't the easiest thing in the world to get these. So I commend the chair who's brought these to us, and look forward to having some new faces on the fair board. It's entering an exciting time, and so new blood is a good thing.
Yes. Okay. Commissioner Duda?
No.
Oh. No other questions or comments? Please vote.
What's that?
Next is citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the Board of Commissioners about an item not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to a presentation. United Way of the Midlands would be honored to have the Douglas County Commissioners' continued support for United Way's campaign. And Ms. Glenda Land is here from the United Way. Good morning.
Hey, good morning. Actually, my name is Shauna Forsberg. I'm the president and CEO of United Way of the Midlands. It's a pleasure to be here this morning.
What was your first name?
Shauna Forsberg.
Shauna.
Yes.
Hi.
I apologize. Thank you so much for the opportunity to be here. Douglas County has been a tremendous supporter of United Way for many years, and traditionally had been involved in the United Way campaign in conjunction with the city, and we know that this year that role has been split into two. So I wanted to take an opportunity to share a little bit about what United Way has been up to and answer any questions that you may have. United Way has been serving the Omaha Council Bluffs community for 93 years, and our focus is on providing critical funding for those living in or at risk of poverty. In our community, we have over 106,000 people living in poverty, and the programs that we go to support help those individuals, whether it be providing healthy food options, stable housing, access to health care and mental health supports, providing supports for those that are victims of domestic violence. And we're also providing supports for wraparound programs that help kids be successful in school, as well as those that are looking for financial stability. So we're fortunate to fund 57 agencies in the community and over 122 programs. We know that Douglas County is looking to kick off its campaign in the next couple of weeks, and we're delighted to have your support. I'm happy to answer any questions about how we go about our work, but again, just wanted to thank you for being part of the journey with us.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Give us some perspective in terms of the county's contribution to United Way of the Midlands.
Last year it was over $17,000.
I'm sorry.
Over $17,000 through the employee campaign.
And that's all employee contribution. Mm-hmm. We don't contribute anything.
Correct.
As an entity.
Right.
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 And how exactly does that occur, the employee contribution component? How do they make the contribution?
They're able to contribute through their workplace, so they can either give a one-time donation or have it a deduction from their payroll. So we try to make it as easy as possible and are flexible in the way we do that and work with various companies. We're fortunate to have over 300 organizations in the community support us in this way, and we try to work with them. We do everything from text to give to payroll deduction to one-time donations.
So those actual, you know, check-off documents or whatever that employees receive, how does that mechanically happen?
We work with the payroll departments. And have that deducted through their campaigns, and then those checks are sent to us on whatever frequency makes sense for the organization. And I, in all honesty, would need to look into how yours is set up specifically, but we work within the structure of what the HR departments look for.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
One of the Commissioner Duda. I think we were going to talk about the same. Okay.
Thank you so much for coming down and for sharing with us this morning, Shauna. United Way is very integral to a lot of the work that the county does, and we complement each other, I believe, in our missions. Now, having said that, the county does also have several foundations within mm-hmm. our own family, and I do dream of actually county employees having the choice of continuing to support United Way as so many have for so many years, including myself, or that perhaps we would give them the alternative of supporting either the Douglas County Health Center Foundation, the Community Mental Health Center Foundation, the Extension has a foundation. And I recognize United Way allows you to designate a 501c. The problem is we've had a few members do that, and it has to accumulate till it hits a certain threshold to be triggered, to be passed mm-hmm. on through to the nonprofit.
Minimum, yeah, the minimum donation is $50.
Okay.
So it's a pretty low threshold, and that's just an operating function for us, and that in order to manage the costs that are affiliated with pass-through. So it's a pretty nominal amount that's required before pass-through.
Okay.
And we work really hard to keep our overhead in check. Right now, we have 11.6% overhead. So fortunately, a significant portion of any funding that comes through goes directly to program.
Great. Very good. Thank you.
Well, I think just to piggyback on with Commissioner Duda, I too think that there needs to come a time, because we have grown our foundations within Douglas County's services larger than what we had in the past, and it may be time that we ratcheted that up to our employees versus the United Way campaign. So this was brought up during one of our committee meetings. During our budgeting time, or one of the committee, I can't remember which one, but I think we need to still have conversation about that as we go along here.
I guess for clarifying, versus or in addition to, because I think there's an approach there that
I have a problem with promoting just one. I mean, there's lots of organizations in this community that, you know, I think deserve the campaign that we do for United Way. And so that's a conversation I think the board has to have in terms of in addition to or not.
Yeah, if you'd like us to come in and talk about how our program works, we're more than happy to do that. United Way works really hard to work on behalf of the donors to invest in a broad range of programs across the community, and I think that's one of the benefits of working with United Way, is that the oversight and the analytics and performance that go into ensuring that the programs that are invested in are really driving the change necessary. So yes, we're happy to chat with you. We definitely want to, work with you in the manner in which you'd like to work with us.
So. I think one of the things that Commissioner Duda pointed out, that you have to accumulate so much for the administrative cost to be covered before the money goes to the organization to which you are donating to. So if somebody donates $25, it sits there until there's an accumulation of that 50.
But we have 50,000 donors, so typically that's not a big issue, unless it's a very, very small not-for-profit that doesn't receive a significant amount of designation. So that, I guess, is the beauty of the network as well, that it's an accumulation of the community caring for the community.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. No other questions or comments? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
We'll move to committees, first being the budget. It's just the budget report as presented, unless there's any comments. We still have some money. Human resources, weekly personnel. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. I skipped. I lost my. Okay, that's right. Legislative issues, or weekly personnel report from civil service as presented, unless there's questions or comments. Commissioner Kavanaugh?
When we get done, I have some administrative service matters I want to mention.
On the legislative, are we working on sometime in November, hopefully, to try to figure out a date for a breakfast with the senators after the election, most likely?
Yep.
Good.
Absolutely.
There are ongoing discussions primarily through Senator McAllister's office relative to Turk legislation that he's anticipating submit in January. And as I indicated, I think in our last meeting, he has had meetings with NACO and Turk and invited me to participate. We received some information that I'll share with you, just relative to the calendar of events that we have to be sensitive to. If we make changes in Turk statute, it can have a cascading effect, because certain things are set in statute that have to happen at certain dates, and if you change a date, then it has consequences like in a domino effect. So he's going to be inviting us to come back, and I invite my fellow commissioners to participate in those, and I know that there are ongoing discussions with other senators as well regarding Turk, but it looks like Turk is going to be an issue in the next session of legislature.
Commissioner Boyle?
Yes, I think something you just said was what I wanted to hear, is that you're going to be involving all of us, because this is an issue that I think all of us have opinions about. I certainly do. And I want to encourage you to, who's our NACO representative, Chris?
Commissioner Rogers.
Commissioner Rogers, find out what NACO thinks, because the last thing we want to do is go in and do something that we don't have support for, unless then we may have to go in for some kind of different, you know, special legislation, which is difficult. And some of us, I mean, I have my idea of Turk is to move it to Douglas County. Appeals would be heard in Douglas County, and all this stuff of having going to Lincoln and waiting for 2 years for a decision, and then the decision you don't like. So I think it'd be a service to our taxpayers to get some people up here and maybe figure out a way to have some professional mediators instead of whoever these people are that are appointed, to tell you the truth. That's kind of, those are my thoughts, but I appreciate you getting involved in doing these things. And I know Senator Craighead has,
right,
she's involved as well. And I know it ranges from reforming Turk to abolishing it, so somewhere in between, or maybe one of the extremes, I could support. Thank you.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
That's all I had on that. I wanted to do something in administrative services when we get around to it.
Okay. Madam Chair, I did want to disclose that I'm meeting with the group from Baird Home, the attorneys who came in and spoke on behalf of the Housing Authority. I'm meeting with them to see if there's some legislation that can qualify them for tax-exempt status. And Mike Goodwillie has pledged his help. Oh, he's gone. Well, anyway, he actually didn't pledge his help. But
next item is the resolution increasing the percentage of contribution paid by retirees to the county retiree medical insurance plan effective January 1, 2017. Is there a motion to approve?
So move.
Okay, motion by Commissioner Morgan, seconded by Commissioner Rogers. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
I'm speaking in opposition to this resolution. For a couple different reasons. We are imposing this, or to propose to impose this on retirees who, men and women, work their entire careers, or at least enough to qualify for retirement benefits with Douglas County, and are on fixed incomes in their retirement years. And after the fact, we decide to change the benefit package for them. There was no real discussion of this matter in committee, or really that I'm aware of, with the board before today. It was mentioned in a June 7th committee hearing with a long list of other things that could be potential expense decreases that Mr. Lorenz outlined. But the discussion that took place there was cursory, and no decision, sense of the committee or anything else, was taken. So other than, you know, a passing mention amongst a host of other matters on June 7th, we now come to take this important decision, inflict this on our retirees, and don't really have any discussion whatsoever. These insurance matters, which are important and infect a broad range of people, should be robustly discussed, and should be discussed with our employees' collective bargaining units as well, who should have input before the day of decision. So I oppose this last minute, no discussion decision to impose yet another onerous increase in premiums on retired employees on fixed incomes.
Commissioner Boyle.
I wish you'd been around when the lawsuit was filed, because I made a lot of friends here when I appeared on behalf of the employees against the county. I remember clearly that we told them in writing that we would treat them on par with regular employees, which in this case probably isn't all that good. But in any event, I understand what you're saying, and but a part of the responsibility of the county board is that there are things that we're charged with doing, and this is one of them. And we can't put, well, I guess we could, but it'd be very awkward to put a vote to a vote with the employees what coverage they, what they want to pay. The decision here is whether we're going to cover the costs of care for our employees. And if we decide, if we decided, for example, not to increase the share that everyone pays, then the alternative would be to start looking at removing some of the more costly benefits that we provide, because this is funded not by United Healthcare or by Blue Cross Blue Shield, but by Douglas County taxpayers. And so these are government funds that we're spending, and we decide, and I was involved in it, we decide what coverages will be provided. And I'm not suggesting we cut coverage. I think we have excellent coverage for our employees, but it is expensive. I do wish that this had been brought up earlier, and I don't know the timing, if it's Ann or who it is. It's a little very uncomfortable, because when we talked about moving or selecting a third-party administrator, it was communicated that there won't be any changes, and then this comes. And a lot of us got calls and said, what do you mean no changes? Look what you did to the premium. So it's kind of like the money given to Iran. It's looked at as paying for hostages, you know? That's not what we did. We're not paying for hostages. But what I'm saying is the timing couldn't be worse, because it looks like we're reneging on what we said, that there'd be no changes. So I am going to vote for this. I'm interested in hearing what the employees have to say. But there are some things I don't think my loyalty to unions or to working people can be questioned. I'm a very strong supporter of the rights of employees and making sure they're protected and treated fairly. But this is one thing that while they have opinions, we all have opinions, this is something that the county board is charged with deciding. That's about all I can say.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
And I, join Commissioner Boyle in his observation that, Aon, who hasn't exactly covered themselves in glory recently with their misinformation on the county's health care administrator issue a few weeks ago, did not in any way bring this to our attention. I was at the June 6th meeting. This was not something that Aon addressed. This was something that our finance director brought up, along with a long list of other things, and there was virtually no discussion as to the implications or ramifications that this would have on fixed income retirees. It's a $250,000 savings to us, and by putting that over on people who are on fixed incomes. I don't think that that's a important contribution to our budget when we're sitting on tens of millions of dollars worth of reserves, but I think that it's an important imposition on people who are on fixed incomes month by month trying to make ends meet with their retirement checks that are not being increased. So imposing this on them, I think, is unwarranted. If you feel okay that you want to save $250,000 on the backs of people who have dedicated their careers to Douglas County, go ahead. I don't. These people worked hard for us for a long time. This was the deal, and now we're changing the deal, and I think that's wrong.
Commissioner Rogers.
I mean, I respect everybody's opinion on this. I just want to note the fact that, from what was said, that I don't think this was talked about cursory. I mean, matter of fact, it was in the final budget. And it was talked about in the budget in regards to the action that's there. This, not only in the budget meeting, but in meetings wherever it's talked about money in the county, is always a subject that comes up. So particularly in the budget session, it was there, it was talked about. And so I'm not disputing the choice of the decision or what you want to do to some degree, but the fact that saying it was something that hasn't been talked about, it's the 800-pound gorilla in the room every time the budget's talked about and every time finance and insurance is talked about. And it's always weighed against the fact that how do we balance trying to cover them to some degree and being the fact that we're the only county in the state that does cover. So I think the balance has always been with the rise in that and what the data is showing us where the rise goes, how do you balance the cost and try to maintain that form. So. But it was not talked about cursory. It's a conversation that was there, and it was in the final budget number to some degree, so I think he knew the action was going to come. Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft?
Yes, Joe. How much is this going to cost our average retiree?
I haven't seen the exact premiums yet. Here they are. They're still coming on. The monthly premium, do we know what percent increase that is?
If I could, I think we just sent Marcos out to get the present premium, and we have the new premium, so we're not.
But what we're doing is increasing the employee only contribution from the employee paying 20% to paying 35%, 25 to 40, I'm sorry, and the other one for the family from 35 to 50. So it's a 15% increase in the funding.
Say that again, Joe.
In all health insurance, you know, the county still has a pretty generous plan where the employee only pays 25% of the total cost and the county pays 75%. And then for employee plus spouse or employee plus family, it's currently 35 and 65. So, you know, the county does pay the great majority. And what we're saying here is that we would increase that breakdown for employees, so the split would be 40-60, and for families and spouses, it would be 50-50.
Okay. And further, is that in addition to the 9% increase?
Yes.
Wow. Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. This is a struggle. I don't like either way to vote on this. There's no good winner. But I do have a question for Commissioner Rogers. I was not aware, I'd never heard before, Douglas County is the only county in the state of Nebraska that provides this benefit. Is that what you're saying?
From the discussions that happen in the meeting and the ones that happens every year, it's my understanding that throughout the state of Nebraska, I think Douglas County is the only one that offers retirees benefits. And that's always, like you're saying, this is not an easy decision. It's always been a struggle in the room. And so how do you balance that by maintaining it but still doing it there? So that's why I was just saying to some degree, this conversation is kind of like ongoing. And it particularly gets there around the budget situation. And there's a whole nother conversation in regards to, Commissioner Boyle mentioned the legal piece and the discussion of, you know, that increase would creep up to some degree to balance that. So that's why I was making the point.
All right. Thank you.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
I'm not sure that that's entirely accurate. I think that Lancaster County and Sarpy County both offer retiree benefits. And frankly, even if we were the only one, I'd be proud of the fact that we do. We're also one of the few counties that has an adequately represented workforce, and the men and women who work for us do a great job, are represented, and in collective bargaining have negotiated over time a package of benefits that in part include insurance benefits. So while they may be silent, at least in this discussion so far, I don't think that they have been adequately consulted on these changes. I think that we should at least allow them an opportunity to review this radical change in the insurance policy involving 15% increases in one fell swoop to people's premium obligations, and that in a time when you're not seeing their benefits increase anywhere near 15% in their retirement years. So why don't we just do this? Why don't we just allow them to have some input into this devastating increase proposal that's going to have really bad impacts on retirees' fixed income standard of living? Why don't we have an open discussion in public about that?
Commissioner Kraft.
Patrick, is this something that could be laid over for 2 weeks?
I mean, it's got to go on after the
Well, I'll say a couple of things. One, open enrollment is coming up, and documents are going to be sent to the employees, so time is of the essence. I will also say, and to reassert what Commissioner Rogers said, is that this was part of the budget. It was discussed during the budget process, and because the county board was okay with it, we included it in the budget. So it has been factored into the budget, and if it's now rejected by the board, we will have to factor that in to modify the existing budget to account for that.
Okay, but I don't think it was pointed out that the increase would be on top of the 9% increase.
Commissioners, every year the county board has to determine whether there's going to be an increase to the premiums for employees and retirees. Some years it's more than others. This year, the recommendation based on our previous claims experience was an 18% increase. The county is recommending that we eat a majority of that, half of it, and we only passed along 9% instead of 18%. So we would eat that out of the health fund reserve. So this decision was made during the budget process prior to the determination that was made how much we're going to have to increase the plan. There are two separate issues.
Okay. I have to agree with Commissioner Duda. This stinks.
Yeah.
Both ways.
No fun.
Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers?
I just want to follow up with the point. Yeah, the whole conversation and the heart of it is trying to maintain, something form. Now, I don't know if the words devastating and radical have been focus grouped and tested it, but I mean, I don't think it's radical or devastating to that degree. It is hard, as Commissioner Kraft and Commissioner Duda said, it's a hard decision, but, a radical decision is basically a decision that everybody's dealing with to some degree, and I agree it's a hard decision, one I definitely would not want to make, but it's the balance of, I guess, trying to maintain the benefits form some way and try to maintain the solvency of it. So I just reiterate, it's a hell of a hard decision not to swallow.
Commissioner Kavanaugh?
I guess every once in a while, having dedicated a career to Social Security law has its advantages. I can tell you this, having talked to people on Social Security and fixed incomes every day for 30 years, increasing the family's pay contribution from 35% of the premium to 50% of the premium, and the individuals from 20% to 35% is both radical and devastating. And if you want to go over to our office this afternoon, I'll let you talk to any number of Social Security recipients that will ratify that. But we don't have to get to that point today. I mean, these decisions should not come to us at the last minute with no public discussion and hurry up and we've got to decide right now. That's what just happened on the change in healthcare administrators. Last minute, hurry up, got to happen right now. Big, big decisions. This was mentioned in passing, and you all have access to the same records that I have relative to the minutes of the committee meetings in the June 7th meeting as one of 8 different items that could be expense decreases. And the entire minutes of that exchange among those 8 is employee fringe benefits. The budget is decreased by changing the proportion of insurance premiums retirees pay towards their health insurance. Currently, a family pays 35% of the premiums, and that would increase to 50%. An individual currently pays 20%, and that would increase to 35%. There was no resolution. There was no consensus. This was a bald statement of the impact of this on our employees, our retired employees. That was it. If you go through the minutes, there's no resolution to that, nor to any of these other factors, some of which were adopted and some were not. But there's no reason that we have to do this today without input from the people that will be most impacted.
Commissioner Kraft?
When does open enrollment start?
November.
November what?
First, I believe.
It's October 28th.
Oh, October 28th. Sorry.
Okay. I'd like to lay this over for 1 week, and I make a motion to lay this over.
I'll second it.
Commissioner Boyle?
I'd like to hear from the employees. We've made our points, but if other lights. Okay, well.
I'm trying.
I understand.
People keep turning their lights on.
All right.
Commissioner Rogers?
And this will be my last comment on for sure. I appreciate the offer to come over to your office, but if I want to learn that experience, I'll call my aunt and a couple other my aunts that deal with this all the time and they're struggling through it. So I appreciate the offer. Other than, you know, and I appreciate the point of the minutes, but, you know, only thing I'm saying is I don't want to be rationalized as if this wasn't given some thought to, it was talked about, and the minutes don't reflect the depth of any conversation. Our minutes that we have at this meeting don't have in detail and brevity the depth of discussion. So I don't want it to be perceived that the minutes don't dictate the depth of discussion that went into it or the seriousness or the pain that may go into the decision that has to go with this. Thank you.
Well, and I just want to comment real quick before I call on all of you, because I agree with Commissioner Rogers that this is over the course of the last 8 years we've talked about this, if not more. And we struggle with it every budget year. And in this budget, those items were all listed as Commissioner Kavanaugh rattled off.
But there was no opposition to it, and that's taken as consensus in the committee to move forward with those deductions within our budget. And so while it is hard, and the premium increase is an increase, there are also across the country through, because of Affordable Care Act, everybody's premium is going up, not just county employees. There are premium, yes they are, I just heard from people, Jim, that their premiums are going up and their cost of insurance is going up. So it's not just us who are all of a sudden throwing this on our county employees. It's not something we like. It's not a piece that we enjoy. But it's one of those items that we try to do in balancing the budget. And you have increase in taxes versus all of these other items that we have to talk about. And so I too don't believe it was a willy-nilly last minute, all of a sudden shock that this is on our agenda to be voted on today. Commissioner Kavanaugh?
I think that I join Commissioner Kraft in laying this over for a week to have a more robust public discussion of this important item. As you recall, several weeks ago, when we certified the mill levy, we also released information that showed that we had an over $5 million surplus in the recent budget year. This is $250,000. That we are taking out rather than doing the right thing with people who basically devoted their entire careers to serving the people of Douglas County. So I don't think that we should willy-nilly take this step today without a robust public discussion and some input from the people most affected, none of which I don't believe were at the June 7th meeting. As a matter of fact, most of those meetings are sparsely attended by the public to begin with. So let's shine a little light on it, see what people think, give them some time to come down and engage us in a public discussion. That's what these public meetings are supposed to be about. The fact that discussions have been had over a period of years on how to reduce what we do for our employees is an interesting observation. I don't think that that's the raison d'etre, the reason that we should have budget discussions to see how little we can do for our employees, but what is fair for our employees. These people make a great contribution to our society in terms of public service, and they need to be adequately compensated and not, after the fact, in retirement, once they're on fixed incomes, penalized for purposes that don't really serve our budget process at all. If we're going to do this, let's do it up front and let the people know that what we're proposing is going to have a radical and devastating impact on retirees.
Commissioner Morgan?
Well, first of all, you know, it is a very difficult decision, but at the same time,
the comment that we have tens of millions of dollars in reserve, I believe, is totally inaccurate. The second thing is, when you talk about this $5 million reserve, I want to have Joe Lorenz speak to that, because that, again, is inaccurate. And the other thing, Commissioner Kavanaugh, that you talked about is that you want to make certain, and I for sure do, that we don't have a mill levy increase next year. And you've talked about that. This is in the budget, and I don't see a reason to have the 1 week layover. I'm not sure what that's going to do. And Joe, would you please, and I know it was in the newspaper and reported, that $5 million and given to all of us also, that we don't have that $5 million reserve.
Yeah, what that $5 million
was. And if I'm inaccurate, I want you to state it and don't be afraid to. No.
That $5 million was the favorable variance in the general fund expenditures. But as I wrote a note, I think, to the commissioners, that over the course of the year, when we do those supplemental expenditures, increases to the budget twice a year, we increase the budget by over $3 million that wasn't funded. So net-net, the real number there was about $2 million. And I think the other thing that you have to keep in context here, and it relates to the next subject on the 9% increase, the number we got based on our actual experience from Aon called for a 17% increase. And we're funding about $2.5 million of that out of the reserve already to bring down the cost. So just to be throwing everything into saying the reserve can cover it really isn't accurate in my mind as the finance director.
Commissioner Boyle?
Yes, very quickly. I did ask the folks on the staff to get dollar figures of what employees are paying now and what is proposed, so we can get a real hard figure on the dollar amount. And the other thing I want to suggest is that during this 1 week layover, which I'm for, I'd like us to compare our coverage with NACO, what the other employees across the state are getting through NACO, and just to see if our plan is maybe extravagant. I don't know, but I'd like to compare us to NACO and see what they're offering through their plan statewide. Marcos, what figures do you have?
I have them.
Okay.
Diane Carlson, Deputy County Administrator. These are figures that just tell you how much more the employee will pay per month in premiums. This is for retirees if you were to pass this.
Diane, could you do the employees, what they're paying now,
sure,
and what they will pay in the future for everybody? I mean, you know, employees and retired.
I can. Do you want me to start with retirees, because
sure,
that's what we're on.
Okay.
Okay, so I can break it down by what they're paying now and what they will pay and what the difference is?
Sure.
Okay. So for employee single coverage retiree, they're currently paying per month $164.52. That's going to go up to $286.93, which is a difference of $122 per month that the employee will see as an increase. For employee plus spouse retiree, they're currently paying $422.53. It would go up to $657.93, and the difference there is $235 per month increase. For family, and these are retirees, for family retiree coverage, they're currently paying $569.51. It would go up to $886.81, and the difference there is $317 a month.
And regular employees?
Okay,
active employees?
This would be, and that included the 9% increase. Okay, and so what we're talking about for regular employees is a 9% increase over their premiums of last year. Do you want me to say what they are now and what they
will
be? Okay.
Please.
And we have two different groups that I'm going to talk about. One is the higher deductible plan. That's the $600-$1,200 deductible plan that I believe FOP-8 is in, and FOP-2. The single coverage is currently $46.07 per month. It's going to go up to $50.21 per month. That's a difference of $4.13 per month increase. Employee plus one dependent is currently $181.08 per month. It's proposed to go up to $197 per month, which is a difference of $16.29 per month. And for family coverage, it's currently $244 per month to go up to $266, so that's an increase of $22 per month that they would pay for family coverage. We have another plan that's we refer to as the lower deductible plan. That's the 300-600 plan that several union employee groups are on. Currently, the employee rate for single coverage is $53.17 per month. It's proposed to go up to $57.96 per month, which is a difference in increase of $4.79 per month. The employee plus one is $209 per month. It will go up to $227 per month, a difference of $18 per month. And for the family coverage, the employee contribution is currently $281 per month. It will go up to $307 per month, which is a difference of $26 per month increase.
Okay. That's very helpful for me. I also would like to know, somebody, if you could tell us how many retirees that we have. I mean, what do we have, 60, 70, 80, 200? I'd like to know that figure too, but I'm just curious about that. But that, I don't need that this minute, but sometime. Thank you very much.
And Commissioner Duda?
Well, I just a follow-up on that, Commissioner Boyle. I think the number of retirees is not as relevant as the number of retirees that are not yet past age 65. I mean, that's the group that we're focused on. Those 65 and above, we aren't providing coverage for.
Oh,
so
yeah,
it's just that gap that we're focused on.
Yeah, thank you. That's right. Thank you.
And just before we start comments, I do have to say, correct, Commissioner Kavanaugh, I didn't say I sit at budget meetings and think about how to screw our employees. I didn't say that. I didn't say I think about how can we deduct all of these benefits that we have for them. I sit there and I think of all of the things that we have to look at in terms of balancing our budget. And it's not on the backs of the employees. So I just needed to correct that. Brian?
I am Brian Perzak, president of FOP2. I represent the deputies, sergeants, and lieutenants at the sheriff's office. One of the things that was brought up today and cost of living, the cost of providing products. I don't think anybody in our union or some of the other unions or employees wouldn't dispute that there is some increase in cost over time. You know, hence this year we have the lump sum of 9%, but I understand it's being shared with the county. The side of this that I'd rather speak to, and it's since we're on the retiree portion, is for the county, they have to have, they have a wage and benefit package that attracts and retains quality employees. And as part of that plan, as you work through your career, a pension takes a lifetime to build up, and retiree health insurance has to be looked at in that vein also, because it takes time to fund your savings to make sure you have enough money in retirement to continue paying for health insurance during that, well, at least the initial county transition period, which could be anywhere from 10 to 15 years for an employee, and then beyond that into the Medicare years. If we go back to 2009 and starting in 2010, that's when the first change occurred. At that time, current employees, retired employees, were all paying the same out-of-pocket share, 7% and 15%. In 2010, that change for retirees went to 25% and 35%, 25 for single, 35% for family. While on the surface, you see that for a single, that's only 18% that employee's out-of-pocket actually went up over 250% that year. For the family, the out-of-pocket share went up 133%. So you can't just call it an 18 and a 20% increase. Those employees that were already entired, they're on a flat pension. We have not a cost of living in some years. They had no time to prepare or address that. And even for those employees that were working here at that time, I can tell you when I started in 98, I was told in retirement 7 and 15%. Well, so midway through, 12 years into my career, that's changed. So that only leaves me anywhere from, 15 to 18 years to try and recover that. Now, 8 years later, 7 years later, we're increasing our, we're proposing to increase our retiree share again, 15% on each side, 25 to 40% for single, 35 to 50% for family. Well, again, that's not just 15% for each of those groups or for those premium shares. Out of pocket is going up 60% for a single and 43% for a family. So you cannot just look at these, well, we're only going up 15%. You got to look at what it's actually costing the retiree out of pocket or the upcoming retiree in 15 years, something that they have to plan for. And when we do this mid-career or after career, they have no time to adjust or find the income with the flat pension and no cost of living increases. As I started with this, I don't think any employee would dispute that we can't, that there wouldn't be increases to our premiums. I mean, the cost of everything does go up over time. I mean, it's going to be passed on. We understand that. But what we're proposing to do here in 17 and what happened back in 10 is, I mean, as I said, an employee has to go 25, 30 years to try and plot out what it's going to cost in retirement. We already have to make the assumption that our health care and costs, the total premium, is going to be going up a percentage every now and then. It hasn't gone up in a few years. We're going up 9% this year. But mid-career and even post-career, to slap on this higher out-of-pocket cost is not just small percentages. It's big dollars that comes out of these employees' pockets. So I just wanted to state that.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Thanks for coming here today. Very interesting observation, and I think this is exactly what I'm concerned with, is what you're pointing out, which was not outlined at all in the budget process. That is the impact on individual county employees. I also want to thank you and your fellow sheriff's deputies for the important contribution that you make to the safety and welfare of our community. I'd urge you to reach out to us individually in the interim, presuming that we are going to lay this over, with an outline of the information that you just gave us, and engage us individually in that discussion, because you're absolutely on point as far as I'm concerned, and I want to thank you for coming here and taking time out of your day to help us with this tough decision. Appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Commissioner Rogers.
Brian, I'm just interested. So are you using a multiplier effect in respects to how you get from those percentages to the higher percentages?
So what you got to look at, so if we look at right now, the single employee is paying 25% in retirement, and it will go on to 40. That 15% increase of the 25 that he was paying initially is a 60% increase in his out-of-pocket.
Anything else, Commissioner Rogers?
No, I just want to see that at some point.
Okay.
Commissioner Boyle?
First, I really appreciate the dollar figures. It helps me a lot to deal with real figures and the percentages, and are, I think, for the employees, somewhat reasonable in light of what we're covering. The retirees bothers me a lot. But an employee on retirement by himself or herself, the premium would be increased 74.4%. An employee plus one person is increased 55.77%. An employee plus a family member, the family coverage, goes up 55.74% as well. Those are really big time. I think I'd like to focus particularly on the retirees. And I, during this interim in a week, I'd like to look into, it's probably off the wall, but I do those things, see whether or not we can buy a policy through Blue Cross or somebody, United Healthcare, anybody, to insure these employees separately. Maybe we can drive down the cost instead of paying it out of government funds that we actually pay for a policy. I don't know if it's possible because of the coverage that retirees need, the kind of services they need. The other thing is, somebody mentioned to me, I think it was Mr. Kraft, that maybe the Affordable Care Act could kick in someplace. We could find a way to make that work. But I really can't vote for a 74% increase for our retirees. I mean, that's just over the top. And we need to figure out a way to, and there are 350 people who are in this group. So it's not a small amount of money, but we need to figure out how to make this work. I want to hear what the employees have to say as well, but I just wanted to bring that up, that it's a little bit too much for me.
Commissioner Kavanaugh?
And then I kind of appreciate what Commissioner Boyle is saying in terms of let's look at some alternatives and take more of a long informed view. But Brian, if you could supply us with what you just gave us in a written form, that would be very helpful. I mean, I think that those massive increases over time are something that we weren't presented with up till now. And I'm glad that you brought them up and put pencil to paper and gave us some real numbers that have, you know, really a staggering impact on people on fixed income. So would you please submit those to us in writing?
Yes.
Thank you. I'll do
that. Commissioner Morgan?
The only thing with, and I appreciate your percentages, but what we should be looking at is what the percentage is in the amount of dollars, because we're taking, for example, if I said, hey, I'm going to raise, whatever it is, the cost 20% to 32%, that's 60% increase, okay? So what I'm saying is we ought to look and see if I'm paying $100 for my premium, is that a 60% increase if it goes up to 130 or whatever it is? Let's do the real dollars rather than taking the percentages, and I think we'd have a better picture. And if we are laying this over, which I'm not in favor of, but if we are laying it over, I'd prefer it be 2 weeks, and I'd like to see us do some work on the percentages, and I want to be sure, you know, that we start messing around with the budget and then figuring out where the money's coming from after the fact. We need to be careful. So I want to get those percentages and work with the staff, and we may have a meeting up in 903 in 10 days to go through it or at some point. Okay.
Patrick?
I think you're going to need to do this in 1 week, not two. We can get you the information. I think two is going to be too close to open enrollment for this to be get done. So I would ask 1 week, and I would ask if the county board cannot come to some kind of a comfortable consensus, then just table it for a year.
The only thing, Patrick, is we were not going to meet on because of Columbus Day, and I am scheduled to miss that meeting next week. That was another thought. Somebody else said 2 weeks also when we were talking. So I don't know. Still don't know if we're voting to lay it over.
Did you have anything else?
I think there may be somebody else who wants to talk.
Anybody else want to speak on behalf of this item? And right now, just for clarification, we're on the retiree one.
Morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Matt
Lewis, Fraternal Order of Police, Lodge 8 President. I'm joined up here today with Vice President of Lodge 8, Dave Aldridge, President of the African American Correctional Officers Association, Sergeant Kenneth Matthews. We stand before you today as representatives of approximately 400 current uniformed staff members and some retirees, some of which are in this room today. You know, I had a prepared statement. You guys have hit a lot of my concerns, and I appreciate that. But when we talk about retiree, and I understand we're talking about the retiree increase, but I also want you to think about how it affects the current employees. Right now, corrections, we've talked about other topics that are affecting morale at corrections. Okay, we've got a high population right now, which is drastically raised the amount of mandatory overtime. Morale's low. In our last contract, the FOP was, as the sole bargaining unit, was forced to agree to a retirement for new hires, which in our opinion is ridiculous. We've got people that have to work till they're 65 years old with a maximum 40% pension. And Patrick, I understand that's a contract issue, so I'll move on. But the reason I bring it up is because of what we're doing to these people, okay? We've got retirees in this building that are on a fixed income. When the figures were brought up for a family premium is $886. $886 a month for health insurance if they haven't reached the age of 65 yet. I don't know what the average pension is, but I know when I retire, I'm probably looking at about a $3,000 to $3,500 a month pension before everything else comes out. That's a large portion of my income as a retired individual. And what's going to happen between now and 7 years from now when I can retire? Now we're telling these new officers who are trying to maintain and recruit quality individuals to the department, which I think we have a quality staff right now. But imagine what that's going to do. We've already seen the effects of the retention because of this new pension plan. We have senior officers that are hitting those 10 years that are looking for other places to go already. Now we're throwing an increase in benefits or in our cost for benefits. We've already told the 21 and 22 year old people that are walking in the door, hey, you're not going to retire from here. You can't work in that job till you're 65. Now if you do retire from there with a 40% pension, we're going to take $900 a month to cover your family. This is affecting not only our retirees, but it's affecting the retention and the morale of the staff currently at the building. We're in a stressful job the way it is. People don't want to work in corrections. And with information that's coming forward now at paying $900 a month to cover my family when I retire, why wouldn't I want to go to OPD? Or why wouldn't I want to go be a Lancaster County Sheriff or some other law enforcement agency? It's not only going to affect the pocketbook, it's going to affect the county as a whole and the quality of staff that you're going to be able to hire. These people are looking at long term when they walk in the door, and that's what it's truly going to affect. Not only the pocketbook of these people out here, but the department as a whole in the future. I ask that you guys consider those issues when you talk about this. If you lay over for a week, consider those issues. And I appreciate Brian Parazak, brother of the FOP, bringing up those figures, because you know, when you hear 15%, you know, yeah, that's not much. But when you bring up the actual numbers of 300 and some odd dollar raise monthly, and it ended up being, Brian, 70-something% raise? 60, I'm sorry. So thank you for your time, commissioners, and your consideration.
Thank you, Matt. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Matt, Dave, Vince, thank you for coming today, and we appreciate your input, and we look forward to having a discussion with you over however long the layover is about exactly the same things that you brought up. And I think, you know, in light of current events where we can't hardly pick up the paper without seeing a front page article about the state's correction system problem because of just what you said, not adequate compensation for their corrections officials, and all of the cascading bad effects that has on public safety, it's important that we take into consideration that the numbers that we just got from our staff indicate that for a family, the increase would result in almost a $4,000 a year increase to these people on fixed incomes. There's no way that I can see, and maybe I'm wrong, and maybe you can enlighten me,
that they're going to pick up $4,000 from some other source of income related to their pension or to their retirement benefits. They're certainly not going to get a $4,000 bump in their Social Security check. So how we get to a fair place on this is important to me, because what you do and your fellow FOP members do is essential to the safety of our community. And we respect the fact that every day you go to work, you lay your life on the line, as do our brave men and women at the Sheriff's Department, for us. And we want to make sure that in compensation for that dedication that you portray that keeps us all safe, that you're adequately compensated during the job and that you're allowed to retire with dignity. And so I think, you know, when we have these discussions, let's go into that $4,000 a year bump for retired families and where does that come from, if anywhere. We must have a fair and public discussion of that. So thanks for coming down. We appreciate the input.
Appreciate that. I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Matt.
Just one comment on that, Commissioner Cavanaugh, and take it for what it's worth. There is a fix to that and a way to come up with $4,000. It's called dedicating 25, 30, 35 years of your life to corrections, retiring and going and getting another full-time job. That's how you come up with that, too. So you have enough money on top of your pension to pay these premiums.
Commissioner Kraft.
Trying to turn, there we go. Okay, at our dais here when we're talking, many times we talk about the quality of our employees and the longevity of our employees, and we're very proud of it. Then that's because we created a culture that inspired people to stay with us. We created that culture that helped us keep the most qualified of the qualified. And your points are so very well taken. If you are earning $35,000 a year as a correction officer, let's use $40,000, it's easier to do in my head, and you retire at 40% of your income, then you said that's the maximum, correct?
Under the new retirement plan for a new hire. Yes,
for a new hire. Okay, so your maximum is $16,000 a year. Now, if you're required to pay $900 and how much per month?
I believe it was $886 and some change.
$886, $900 a month. You're talking about 9 times 12, $10,800 a year out of that $16,000 just to pay for your insurance.
Correct.
And when this was discussed, I don't think we looked at all the nuances of what the repercussions could be on the family. And family is very important. If I was a retiree and got hit with this increase, I think the stress alone could cause more illnesses. We want quality employees, and especially positions like yours and yours. We need quality employees in these positions so we don't end up like the state has. We need trained officers, we need quality officers, we need good officers. And if we don't take care of you, and you change and go to work for OPD or Council Bluffs Police Department or anybody, you're in front of the worst of the worst, 8 hours, 9 hours, 10 hours a day, each and every day. A police officer or our sheriffs only see those same individuals once a week, 2 times a day. It's not constant being on, they're constantly on their guard. They have to be, but it's not the same type of constant on your guard as being confined in a confined space with the worst of the worst. I want to thank you for what you guys do, both the Sheriff's Department, the Corrections Department, and all of our employees.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Commissioner Boyle.
Yes, I wanted to ask Patrick and Joe to kind of drill down into some of the costs and really explain what you're talking about to table this, table what for next year, and what's the financial impact of that, and you know, to the retired employees, to the employees, and to the county taxpayer. Can you give me that? Is that too much?
There's two separate issues. One's the retiree issue, which I'm more concerned about. That. And then the 9%, again, it could have been 17%. We're asking that you approve that because an increase is expected every year. The retiree issue is more obviously more complicated, and HR has to send a letter out to employees for open enrollment prior to the beginning of open enrollment, and employees and retirees need to know what the cost of the insurance is so they can decide whether to take it or to waive out of it. So that's why we're asking for a decision either to be made today or next week, and if the board does not feel comfortable with doing that, then I would ask that for the retiree issue, that if you can't decide it next week, table it for a year and discuss it next year.
And what's the cost of that?
Well, it's $250,000 to the budget, which, again, it was factored in for the retiree cost, was factored into the budget, so we would pull $250,000 additional out of the out of the health insurance fund reserve fund, in addition to what we're pulling out. $2.3 million that we're pulling out for the increase that we're covering, the half of the increase for all of the employees.
Okay, so you're saying we must next week, if this table passes, we must act on the employee portion and raise them all this
9%.
Employee portion, raise it up. Is it, let me ask Matt, is the hearing the figures on the employees, you know, single employee going up $4.13 a month, and the employee plus one going up $16.29, and an employee plus family coverage going up $22 a month. I'd like to ask you, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but is that totally too much? Do you think that's too much?
You know, we're always going to, from a labor standpoint, we're always going to argue an increase in anything.
Sure.
That's what we do, but I guess my biggest concern is not necessarily an increase. I understand that things happen, you know. Cost of living increases. And not meant in a disrespectful manner, but if we knew about this or the board knew about this when you're talking about a budget, and I keep hearing about we need to get this done, why did it not come before the board until October? And that's what's upsetting some of the unions is, we had time to talk about this. Had we known about it previously, had the board brought it forward, put it on an agenda previously, maybe we could have come to, and I know it's your decision. I can't make the decision, neither can the union, but why wait till October when we know open enrollment is October 28th? And I think that's just to rush everything in and let's get it done because it has to be done. Let's not discuss it because it has to be done. We got to get this done so these employees can be ready for open enrollment. That's what I question.
Well, let me tell you, some of the commissioners have complained about that, where we have to, you must vote today thing, and it is what it is. But some of this stuff could have been, I think, stretched out, and I agree there could have been more discussion. But I'll tell you the truth, I'm not sure that, you know, a $22 increase for an employee under the $600-$1,200 deductible, employee plus family amounts to $264 a year. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know that 264, but I don't know if that seems to me that maybe in the ballpark that's reasonable. So I guess what I'm thinking about is what if we approve the employee portion, you know, next week, and then did some things to leave the retired employees alone, because their percentages are so high, 74% for a single. I mean, that's just, wow, $122 a month increase. You know, so anyway, I just wanted to hear what you have to say, but I'm going to vote for the layover, and hopefully we can have some further discussion on this.
Commissioner Kavanaugh?
Yeah, he's retired.
I think Commissioner Boyle brings up some great points, and we probably need some more information from our staff and from our employees before we can make a decision on this important matter. But one of the things I guess we would need more information on is, okay, what's the basis of the request for this massive increase? You know, break it down for us. And, you know, there's nothing here that's rocket science, but that explanation has not been made to me, it wasn't made in the public hearing at the Finance Committee back in June, and there's been no discussion at these board meetings since then. So Commissioner Boyle, who's brought this up repeatedly, and I commend him for it, makes a good point that we shouldn't be doing these things rush at the last minute. We should have, you know, an adult conversation in public about these things leading up to this. We've had months that we could have had that discussion, and now we're told, well, you got to do this right now because open enrollment's just around the corner. Well, I'm sorry, that's a heck of a way to run the county, and we shouldn't run it ad hoc like that all the time with important stuff. What we do have is a balance in the health insurance fund. What that is, I don't know. I'd like to know that, because that possibly could offer us an alternative. Those two things, what's the cost increase based on, and what's our health insurance fund balance reserve, are really important, I think, numbers to have before we go ahead and make either one of these decisions. But I'm on board with Commissioner Boyle's observation that we should quit running these things in a knee-jerk, last-minute fashion on important decisions, particularly important insurance decisions that affect everybody.
Commissioner Rogers?
Patrick? The decision whether or not to increase the premium by 9% was recommended 17%. That's something that's actuarially determined by our consultant based upon our claims experience. It's done at this time every year because we need to have sufficient information in order to do that actuarial determination. So this is something that the county board goes through every year. So it's not, we did not sit on this information, we just received that information. The retiree information is something that we did discuss, or again, it was presented to the board in the Finance Committee meeting during the budget process. The reasoning for it, it's simply math to make the budget work to avoid a tax increase. There was a $5 million hole that the county had to fill. The staff was asked for its recommendations on how to fill that, and we came up with some recommendations, some which were accepted, some which weren't. So $250,000 is simply part of the equation to make the budget work. It could have come out of some other budget, but the county board decided to take that action, or to accept that recommendation.
Matt?
Can I make, I'll close with this if I could. I've heard some things and I just would like some clarification if I may. Patrick just said that the 17% came up here recently, but we've been told that it was talked about in the budget meeting in June.
The retiree cost was talked about in the budget. The decision to change it from, or the recommendation to change it from 25-35 to 40-50 was discussed at the Finance Committee meeting during the budget process. The increase was not discussed because we don't get that information until this time of year, because our actuary has to do a lengthy analysis of our claims history, of our recent claims history, in order to get that done. Again, this is something that has been accepted by the board every year that this is discussed at this time. If the county board wants to change the time frame in order to try to do that, we can sit down with our consultant and see if there's any way to move up the process earlier than this.
Commissioner Rogers?
I mean, I guess I better get in now. Two issues kind of got put together here. So let me say, you made the point. Any increase, there would be issue with. But I think, but let me state the fact that, because I don't want this to be misconstrued about the respect I have for any of the jobs anybody does to some degree. Got a large amount of respect for that. But I think the context of this is that across the country, there are, as far as I've seen, 50, 30, 20% increases in insurance. And this is the nature of the industry. It can be afforded. So I'm just saying that to say this is not a light decision anybody's taking to some degree. Some people are absorbing a great amount of it. And this is, as you said, we didn't do it the last couple of years. We can put it off, but it's going to come again. And it's going to come compound interest. So I'm just saying, as long as the healthcare environment is what it is, this will be something faced by everybody. And so I just think we've tried to come to the best way we can to some degree to admit it, even though it's not the retiree piece. The regular insurance tried to split it. The retiree piece is going to be a strain anywhere it goes. And I just want to make sure, you know, if somebody was to stay to 65, they're going to be on Medicaid. They're not Medicare. They're not going to deal with this part. So this is the complicated part, that age group that decided to retire before they were 65. So I'm just saying the context of this is the health environment is what it is. Some people are begging for, if some people can get 9-10% increases, that's what it, that they would beg for that. It's the volatility of it, it's what it is, and I don't think there's an easy part to it, and the choice doesn't get any easier if you put it off a year.
Matt?
I'll leave you with this, and it's been explained to me, but I just want to bring it up because it's a concern for many of the people that have come to me. The perception that the employees had when we went to Blue Cross Blue Shield, and it's been explained to me that this has nothing to do with Blue Cross Blue Shield, I understand that now, but our 400 employees down there, when they heard there was going to be no changes, the perception was there wouldn't be any changes, and that's really upsetting people down there. You know, we didn't really try to come up and voice an opinion over this change, whatever, because we were told everything was going to stay the same, and all of a sudden now they're telling us we got to pay 9% more. So that's been a complaint that's been brought forward to me. I told them I would bring that complaint forward to you, but I appreciate your time. Don Fricke's up here. He's one of our retirees, also would like to speak. So thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Morning.
As most of you know, I'm Sergeant Don Fricke. Worked down in corrections from 1978 to 2012. You know, I gave my heart and soul down there. And, you know, all these years, the county said they were going to take care of me, you know, pay the same amount as the regular employees. You know, I did a lot of work down there, and I got two neck fusions in my neck from working down there. I can't afford this increase. You know, the rug got pulled out on us, you know, as Mayor Boyle said. I urge you guys to reconsider this. I can't work anywhere else. I got constant pain in my shoulder. That's all I have to say. Please. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug.
Well, I'd like to see us do something today on setting aside the increases for the retirees. And, I don't know what motion would be appropriate. I think I'd defer to the people who count the money. And What would you say, Patrick? What's an appropriate motion? If I want to lay this, you know, set.
I would just say no. Just vote no.
Well, I know, but do we have one to table it? We don't have one.
Well,
to
you could either, you can move to table it, or you could just vote no, and bring it. Somebody can bring it up next year. It's.
So we have to separate it.
Yeah, there are separate. The first, they are. Okay. They're separate issues. The first one you're talking about right now is retirees.
Okay. And there already is a motion on the floor.
Delay over for 2 weeks. Well,
delay over.
Madam Chair, if I may.
For 1 week,
one
sorry.
To approve,
prior to that motion by Commissioner Kraft, there was a motion by Commissioner Morgan and a second by Rogers to approve. So.
Right.
Oh, okay, thank you. Yeah. I forgot about that.
Michelle Winger, Employees United Labor Association. It has kind of hit everybody down at Corrections and County Hospital and up here at the Civic Center. Blue Cross Blue Shield was kind of thrown on our plate a week before. Again, explained that there would be no changes. With the retirees being on a fixed income, when you're looking at the $250,000, well, according to the figures I was sent when we were choosing Blue Cross Blue Shield, the first year you're going to save $142,182 in administration fees, $39,520 in a stop-loss coverage, and Blue Cross Blue Shield is also giving the county $100,000 credit in implementation costs. Right there, you're offsetting your retirees almost to that full amount. So my suggestion is that we don't put this burden on people who have worked for us and who have retired for us and put them in a fix where they can't fix it. Thank you.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Excuse me. Sorry. Could you submit that testimony to us? I think you make some really interesting points. You know, and we're interested in looking at alternatives to imposing this huge increase on our retirees who've dedicated their careers to helping us. And I'd also like to thank Sergeant Tricky for coming down. I know it's not easy for you, but and thanks for your years and years of service to us. But if you could submit that to us, I mean, I think that's a basis for discussion, and it should all be in. It should all be on the table. So thanks a lot.
Commissioner Boyle?
Just a comment about the we promise no changes thing. What I took that as, and we should have been much more clear in our language, it really, to me, meant no change in coverage, because we're not buying an insurance policy. The county spends the money, taxpayer dollars. All we're changing is the person, the company that pays the bills. To me, that's what it amounts to, and nothing else. So, and one of the ways to drive down the premiums, one of the options, as I mentioned earlier, is to look at the coverage. Are we you know, a Mercedes in coverage? I mean, how good is it? You know, we have bariatric surgery, which is, I think, 18 or 20 grand right at the outset. So, I mean, and all those things start to pile up. So, I mean, one of the things I'd like to do, and I'd like to see us meet on Wednesday at 9 o'clock up in 903, so we'll get a legal notice out so we can talk about this. But that's one of the options. I mean, I don't want to see any coverage go away, but what really is driving these increases? We need to know. Is it heart? Is it diabetes? Is it, you know, what is it? That's one thing, but it is it's unfortunate, you know, because when we said no changes, it was a reference to coverage, but and we should have, you know, I don't like the idea of blasting the administration, but it is difficult to look you in the eye, because I think you think we're lying about no changes, because the premiums are going up. That's not intended. The timing could not be worse. So I'll quit talking. I want to hear what you have to say, unless there's somebody else.
No, go ahead, and then I'll call on Commissioner Moore.
Dolores Selby. I worked at Douglas County Corrections for 26 and a half years. I retired in December 2015. And I just like to say that $122 increase that you're giving to myself, for I cannot afford that. And I think if there was more retirees that heard about this, I heard about this last night at 10 o'clock when I talked to Sergeant Matt Lewis, and that's why I'm here today. Because I know if all the other retirees knew about that retired from the county that were less than 65 years old, and they had time, because I don't have a job, but I don't go to work in the morning, but a couple of my friends that are retired, they couldn't make it today. I called them at 10:15 last night. And they said, we cannot go, you need to go. So I think you'd have a lot more retirees down here complaining that they could not afford that $122 increase for a single person. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Commissioner Morgan?
Well, I've been talking to Joe a bit, trying to figure out a way, if there's a way to compromise this a bit. And Joe, you had some ideas where we could make a cut on this, on the part they pay 5%, I think. Go ahead.
Yeah, obviously it's a dramatic increase, but we have to trade that dramatic increase off the cost of retiree health insurance, which is by far the most expensive insurance that the county offers on a per capita basis, which would make sense given the age of the employee. So it does cost more in terms of claims. So, you know, in trying to look at how we could potentially handle this would be potential, instead of making such a dramatic increase, instead of having the increase go from 25% to 40% and 35% to 50%, have it go from 25% to 30% and 35% to 40%. So only bring it up 5% instead of 15% this year, and give us the time over the course of the year to really examine the retiree medical program and other options that might be available to reduce the cost. But in the meantime, you know, reduce the increase this year from 15% to the 5%.
At least trying to come up with some. The difficulty is what this is costing
yeah.
everyone today. And I mean, the other thing you see happening is for individuals that don't have this kind of, you know, health insurance from like the county or government or some subdivision of government, oftentimes they can't even buy insurance because so many of them pulled out of the market for individuals today. Blue Cross, United, a lot of them just pulled out of the market for individuals.
Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I asked Joe, what are the, Lorenz, what the actual cost is, because percentages are percentages, and I deal a lot better with it's going to go up $45,000 or it's going to go $18.
Right.
So, Joe, would you, and on the retirees, what was, what is the increase proposed now, and what are you proposing?
Well, as they were throwing out the numbers, if it went for a single person, if it was went 15 to 40, it was going to be a 60% increase.
Okay.
But so if you did this way, so it would only be five.
Joe, talk bucks. Talk.
I will, Mike. Let me get there. Let me follow my logic. It would only be five. So five over 25 would be a 20% increase. So it would be a third. So if the single would go up $122, a third of that would be approximately $40. So these increases would effectively be one-third of the original proposal.
What would it be for an employee plus one?
It would be,
Diane may have some numbers to
I have to
assist.
Get my...
I've got my shoes off. Can I help?
It would be $78.
Okay, it goes from what to 78?
78. Instead of being 235, it would be 78.
Okay. So, and how about the employee plus family?
So it would be reduced from 317 to 105. Okay. So yeah, it would be like a third of what was originally.
So Commissioner Boyle, what I was trying to do
yeah.
is we know health insurance is just constantly
sure.
increasing. You said yep. that earlier too. I'm trying to figure out a way we could try to compromise it,
yep.
be fair, and we always try to do that, and we also try to make sure we don't have mill levy increases either. But Joe's telling us that we could do that. We did a budget, you know, all of us were there. And this would be a compromise that we could still not have some other challenge facing us in the months ahead. And that's a concern I have, Joe. And I assume you have it. You can say no. I hope. If you
yes.
don't, that'll be great.
No, I do.
So I'm trying to figure out, hey, if we did this, we're really cutting it back substantially.
When you say this, what do you mean?
Made this change and reduced it down from those numbers you just... receive from Joe.
Okay. I think, you know, some of them are still a little bit high for my money.
Dave.
Hi. Dave Aldrich, Vice President of FOP Lodge 8. I'd like to thank Brian and Matt for speaking on these issues earlier.
Yeah.
I just wanted to speak on an issue we had. A few weeks ago, we celebrated a gentleman who was retiring, 61 years old. He called me last night wishing that he didn't retire now because he did not budget for this retirement. Him and his wife didn't set the money aside. They, the extra $300 a month, they didn't plan on spending. So now, he was asking how he could come back after retiring as maybe a part-time or just to get a job back at the correctional center just to cover some of the costs he's going to get from this raise. It was back and forth whether it was devastating or not devastating. I think we've heard from a couple of retirees how devastating it would be, actually. We asked, Lodge 8 asked that you set this aside for a year. We discuss it then without any raises on the retirement. Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft.
A number of years ago, we talked to the union about using part-time employees to cover overtime and things like that. This would be an excellent opportunity and on a short-term basis.
That's in the contract.
Oh, I can't talk about okay.
Well, it's prohibited in the contract.
Yes, it's prohibited in the contract. Because I think it would be an excellent opportunity to allow some people who've retired.
Actually, the CIR court ruled against that, allowing part-time help.
They did. Okay. I'll stop talking then.
Okay.
Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers, did you have your...
I want to make the point since you brought it up. I'm not speaking to devastating. Devastating is in the eye of the beholder. Everybody's, I don't know anybody's kitchen table, $10 can be devastating. I'm not saying that. My point is, and I want to make the point earlier, I mean, devastating is being used with terms like radical. It's not radical. This is the healthcare environment that we live in. This discussion that we're having today is what every business is having across the country, every company. So I just want to be clear on the record. I'm not disputing the effect that this will have on anybody. This is a hard as hell decision. So I just wanted that to be clear for the record and let you know I'm not disputing that in any degree.
Okay. Thank you.
And Dave, I want to say that too. I mean, again, I don't sit down and figure out how we can budget our balance our budget on the backs of employees or retirees. All of these issues were talked about, and we had to come up with something without a mill levy increase, and it was already stated by some that we're going to decrease our mill levy next year. So these are just all of the kind of issues that you float through a budgeting process, but it's not because we don't have respect for you. I think each and every one of the commissioners sitting here has proven that we have your backs when it comes to having to work with what or details of what you need to work with over there at Corrections, and we try to make things better.
And we do. We still work well together. There's no doubt on that. But the problem is now we're here to fight for the retirees who no longer have a voice, and that's what we're here for. So we're just asking that you table this for the year. We can discuss it and work on it.
Well, can I ask you something straight up?
Yes.
Even if this was tabled and we brought it up next year, can you honestly stand there? And even the retirees that are here, can you honestly sit here and tell us that you would be supportive of any type of increase to insurance premiums?
I can't speak on that because I'm not retired, obviously. But I'm sure everybody's opposed to an increase.
Right.
But the dramatic increase that was coming forward, that's why I know we're talking about dropping it down to 5%. If we could just table this for the retirees, the employees are obviously different than 9%, but table the retirees for the year, what we're asking for.
Commissioner Rogers?
With that line of questioning, so that's the, well, Commissioner Borgeson took it as kind of the vein I was trying to take it in to some degree, because as the union president stated, okay, a couple of years we didn't do anything, trying to ward it off, but it came. We can hold off another year, but it's going to come back. It's going to come back with a fury. So quite frankly, I think the world you're looking in, okay, we do 5 this year. You're going to probably be looking at 5, 5, or whatever it is. I mean, when you get into the realm, it's not going to be like a constant thing. So to her point, you know, I hear the retirees, they would never agree to an increase, but Commissioner Boyle made the point of wanting to look at the data. And that's the point. The data over the last couple of years has been talking to us and telling us. I mean, we've been trying to balance the point of a lot of the drive and cost is coming out of the retiree pool. And we're trying not to increase it in other places. They are, and because of union negotiations and how we negotiate the contracts, we can't do our insurance benefits like other places are. We're having individuals with risk probably pay higher than those individuals that don't have risk to balance it out. So in that line, I'm just saying we can do 5, but we're going to be back here discussing because of the increase of the numbers and what they're showing in the retiree pool and the calls. We're going to be back here in another year probably at 5, 5, 5. So I'm just saying that in that respect.
And like you said earlier, I don't sit at somebody's kitchen table either, everybody's kitchen table. So these individuals are coming forward. That $100 that they weren't prepared for, like I said, this officer just retired, and he didn't take that big hit into consideration. So therefore, even I don't know how much the 5% would affect them. I think if we tabled it for a year, it would give them more opportunity to get ready, get more prepared for that, find another possible source of income. It would just give somebody more an opportunity than to hit them here in January with that.
Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I am for tabling it for a year, and I asked, just doing some checking, it's the cost, Douglas County taxpayers spend $33 million on this health care, $33 million, and the total budget for corrections is $27 million. I mean, the health care costs are just going through the roof and has been for a lot of years. So I mean, it's we have to come up with some alternatives. And that, at the meeting, I would like to schedule the meeting so we don't have to mess around. I'd like to do it October 6th at 9 o'clock in room 903, and we'll give a legal notice, and so we can have a full house up there and discuss this. But I think we ought to look into reducing some of the coverages offered, and figure out, we ought to look into that. So we're going to have some hard work on our employees coming down and talking to us about what it is that we insure. The other thing is, we need to take into account these increases for the retirees, and I think they have to be a whole lot lower. But we'll table that. The retirees for a year would be very helpful.
I think so.
It's way over the top on what they would have to pay. So that's what I'd propose. And so we had a motion to approve, and it didn't pass, and we didn't vote on it.
We didn't vote on it. Okay. But just a second. Let's finish the lights,
okay,
and then we'll go with what we
all
have
right
on the table. Commissioner Kraft?
Yes, and I want to make sure it's clear that if this gets voted down or tabled, there still is the 9% increase for the retirees also. Am I correct on that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I just don't want any. We've talked about so many things, it could be easily lost in the conversation. So there will be, if it passes, and I think it will, the 9% increase. That increase.
Yes.
But not the other one if we table it. And that's a big if. It depends on the will of the commissioners here. Thank you.
Commissioner Duda?
Thank you. This is a no-win situation. There is no right or pleasant answer. If we were to lay this over, I would urge us to look at other public entities. My sister retired from Omaha Public Schools. She's responsible for every bit of her health insurance coverage. That's how a lot of public entities work. I think we're actually being a little bit generous to try to help with our retirees. Until we went with Rule 75, this was never an issue. It was the rising health care costs kind of caught us off guard, and suddenly this became a problem that we historically did not have. I don't see what we're going to gain in laying it over for a week or two. It's not going to change that much. The retirees still won't want it. We still won't want to do it, and yet budgetarily, it was one of the fundamental pieces that we used to balance the budget this year when we directed Joe Lorenz to come up with a budget that could work without raising the tax rate. I would be willing to live with the compromise that Joe threw out for us today, that instead of bumping them 15%, we only bump them 5% this year. The need for ongoing conversations about what do we do next year? Do we reduce coverage to reduce costs? These are going to be complicated talks, nothing we should be rushing into. I think that compromise that Joe offered is reasonable. It's about as far as I can comfortably go. I mean, we have to do something to keep our balanced budget long term. And I think this is a trend that's going to continue. I think Commissioner Rogers is right. If we just do the 5% bump this year, I think it's probably pretty inevitable there will be another little bump next year, perhaps another 5% bump. But I also get what Sergeant Fricke is saying. You know, this much at one time is a real challenge. And so I would prefer if we could phase it in a little bit better. I think that would be a little bit more palatable. There's a basic, I get Sergeant Fricke saying he's got health issues from his job, and therefore it would be hard for him to go get another job. It's hard for me with two jobs to look at people younger than me saying, what are you doing saying I've got to work? Well, okay, sorry if you have to work for health insurance reasons, but I really don't know that we ever promised people that they could retire at 55 and we'd take care of them with everything for the rest of their lives. I sure don't remember that, and we've never been able to come up with anything in writing that substantiated that we ever said that. I want to help. These are good people. They've given a lot for us. I appreciate what they've done. I want to help them. I want to be reasonable. But we've also got to be reasonable to the taxpayers. And we can't afford to be as generous as we would really like to be with every employee that we've got. You know, ideally, we'd pay all the health insurance. I wish we could do that for everybody. But the taxpayers are going to be the ones stuck with the bill at the end of the day. That's the balancing act that we have to do. I could live with that compromise. I see that going forward, that this is probably going to continue trending upwards, and I think that would be a reasonable approach for us to take today. Thank you.
I don't know if we're going to compare yours two jobs to Sergeant Fricke getting another job. I think he was referring to his injury out of the jail, and now he can't have another job. That's what I think he was referring to.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And he's not the one. Actually, it was a neighbor of mine came to me last year who's younger than me saying, what do you mean I have to work? And it just rubbed me wrong.
I'll say he's older than 55.
Okay, and he's also not a neighbor. It wasn't him.
Thank you.
Commissioner Morgan?
You know, this is really one of the tougher situations, listening and hearing this. You know, because of the budget and our efforts, and we were very united in what we did on the budget, I would like to withdraw my motion to go forward with this if the second would agree. I'd like to make a motion that we could vote on, you know, now, and that would be to take what Joe and I discussed as a compromise, a negotiated, fair situation. And Chris, I think you had maybe a question that you want to ask Joe, or you're okay?
The rumor mill has floated down here that we were at the 5% compromise, so I just wanted to confirm so I can be on board with you with taking it.
And what I'm saying is Joe's telling me we can live with that with our budget. We know that we're going to face some real serious challenges next year. I'm glad that Commissioner Kavanaugh has said he will not be supporting any mill levy increase several weeks ago, if I'm stating that correctly. And I think all of us are going to put our best efforts on that. And I'd like to make that motion that we go with that compromise that Joe proposed, if I can get a second.
Is there a second?
And
Commissioner Kavanaugh?
I think I'm in general support of Commissioner Boyle on his idea to lay it over for a year. You know, we've had an hour's discussion, and all of a sudden it turns out that, hey, we don't have to have this huge honking increase. We can go with a 5% increase. That's based on 60 minutes of discussion. No information other than what you've heard here today has been provided to any of us. No analysis of the long-term implications of doing anything has been provided, and there's no plan to go forward. It's, again, seat of the pants, last minute, let's just talk about it and throw some darts at the target and come up with something. If we can go from, whatever, 15% to 5% in 60 minutes of chatting, we can probably do a better job if we take a week and actually drill down and get some real numbers. And so, you know, I'd be inclined to go with Commissioner Boyle is let's take a real strategic view and move it for a year and make it a real robust discussion involving all of our employees, not people who got the notice yesterday that this is going to have a devastating impact on them, but maybe got a notice that next year it could have a devastating impact. Why don't you come and talk to us about that? I think for all of those reasons, we have time to make an informed decision after an adult conversation, not only with our employees, but with the public on this very important issue. The cost increases are interesting to me in light of the fact that we live in very close to a zero inflation economy. And since in recent years, even health costs have gone up only marginally, the cost increases are something that I'd really like to take a very close look at, because maybe we're dealing with health care providers who are, you know, passing along some increases that aren't warranted by the cost of doing business in the United States of America in 2016. Because cost of living is not going up by these percentages. Your wages are not going up by these percentages. And so why all of a sudden are health care costs going up by these percentages? These are all questions we can't answer this morning in an hour's chat. And I don't think that we can resolve by picking a number pretty much out of the air and saying that that's a compromise that's responsible. I think Commissioner Boyle's got a better way to go forward, which is let's step back, take a deep breath, at least take a week to get some answers to big questions, and maybe longer.
Commissioner Rogers?
There's a lot convoluted in there, but I want to say that, you know, I'm going to support the 5%. I'm not going to support the layover. And I just say it because I hear what you're saying in regards to how it appears to have come up last minute, but I don't agree with that. The conversation's been there. Your analogy about the healthcare market and other stuff, I'm not a healthcare expert, but you know, I understand enough to know that that's not a fair analogy. There's increases up to 50% going on. And if anybody can get a 5% increase, they lay on an altar for a 5% increase to get a 5% increase, yes, in this environment. And I'm glad it's brought up. I'm fine to have this discussion, but this discussion is going to be here until the last of us goes about the health care costs. It wasn't done in a way that was rushed. It was very deliberate and talked about. For the last 4 years, I can remember hearing data every budget cycle, every human resource meeting almost, about the exact people in our insurance pool, the demographic group that's driving it. And so I just want that to be out there, is that this to me is the beginning of a conversation that is going to happen. And Commissioner Boyle is right. I remember the last time we did this about a couple of years ago, we added four or so benefits into this. So this discussion is going to be way bigger and way broader, and the decision is going to be tougher. But this was not done lightheartedly. This discussion has been going on for 4 years, and anybody that sat in those rooms can tell you pinpointly what's driving it, because we've all been told what's driving it. That's why the wellness program was put in, to try to curb that. That's why it's been talk about everything to some degree, to try to curb this health insurance piece. So I wish you could do zero increase. That's not reasonable. I'm with the five, and I hope that everybody here takes the serious conversation of where just the health costs, the healthcare conversation is in this entity and everywhere, particularly in public entities. Because as Commissioner Duda said, nobody else publicly, this discussion is happening nationally. They are writing people off, retirees-wise, government-wise. So this is a discussion we're having. I think 5% is, we've done that out of hearing their concern, which is your democratic process. You came in here and voted your voice. So I don't think this was winning too lacklusterly. Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft?
Yeah, one thing that bears on me is we keep talking 5%, but real in reality it's not 5%, it's 14% for these individuals. And that's a heavy hit. Now, in reality it could be 17%. Yeah, so it is, as you said, convoluted, it's difficult. And the problem with doing 9% this year when it should be 17% is, what is it going to be next year? When it should be 10%, is it going to be the 17%? Are we going to be able to subsidize it next year? So I do not know. I do know that once we start looking at the actual dollars, and if I empathize with my retiree friends and look at how this will impact them and their families, I'd like to lay it over a week to study. And as I recall, there's an active motion on the floor to lay it over. Mm-hmm.
Yes, there was a motion by for 1 week for my craft.
The
second by Boyle.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, and then you withdrew your motion.
I withdrew the one that was added.
I'd like to ask us to vote on the layover.
I do want clarification, because what you just stated is not accurate in terms of the 5% plus 9%.
So the 5% is the percentage increase of the cost sharing. So instead of being 25% of the premium that a retiree single would have to pay, they would have to pay 30% of the premium. The other issue is the premium, and how much does the premium cost? The premium would go up by 9%, so you can't add the 9 and the 5 together.
Thank you.
Brian
Perzak, FOP2. But what you can say is that 5% increase is an actual 20% out-of-pocket increase.
Correct.
So it's not just 5%. And these are people that did not have a lifetime to prepare for this. We're not handing out cost of living increases in our pension. They get a flat pension. That's it. So just compromising at five and feel like you're throwing us a bone is not what's happening here. And something else I'll speak to that was brought up about working towards age 65. And I can tell you, everybody's here, the corrections, sheriff's office, if you want 65-year-old people dealing with 15 and 30-year-old people on the street, then you're going to have some increased health care costs. We're going to have injuries on duties. And so if you're, with their pension being pushed up to 65 and 40%, that's what you're going to see. So you do need to take care of your retirees so we can at least get moving, because law enforcement, corrections, those are professions where you cannot expect a 55-year-old or a 60-year-old to be dealing with an 18-year-old. It's different than having a desk job or working behind a counter or a window.
Okay. Just let me follow up with that, Brian. I'm not disputing the gravity of your job, because it's rough, but you know, I just wanted to say, to put it in context. So let me put it up front and say, your job was hard. Your job is hard. Hard is in the idea of the beholder. But you know, I think the discussion we're having in the context of it is, I never retirement at 55 is a choice unless you get a disability or something and you have to go to some degree. Same argument can be made for my own father that worked till he was 65 on the construction site, on top of roofs and that, on top of buildings. So, you know, that's a demanding deal too. So I'm not saying it's to dispute any of the jobs to some degree. I'm just saying, with the environment you're in, retirements at those age are a choice, and there's a lot of other demanding places too that's pushing the same deal. So the discussion is a way bigger discussion, not dispute. And I would love for everybody to be a retired 55 in your profession, but I just want to put it back in context of the thing we're dealing with and the gravity of it.
And I
respect the job all of you all do in that respect.
And if you ask, and we have a number of retirees that work in our building security here, even though we have the opportunity to retire from a law enforcement or a corrections job sometime after 50 and before 60 or 65, I can tell you that probably the majority of them plan on taking second careers, because we have to be able to pay for those 9% premium increases. So it's not like we retire and take it easy. No, we move on to our third and fourth careers, whatever it's going to be, because we know we got to keep paying for our health insurance. But what's being proposed here, and what happened back in 2010, the retirees did not have time to plan for this. A pension takes time. Retiree health insurance, to plan for that takes time. So that's all I'll say.
I'll skip for now. Thank you. It's been said.
Okay, so there is a motion on the floor to lay over for 1 week. Please vote. Commissioner Boyle.
I just want to mention that the reason that I think it's important to have this meeting is to review the coverage that we're offering to employees, to see if there's something that's really costing us big and maybe it's not being utilized. I think we need to look at the state, Nebraska Association of County Officials, to see what they're paying their employees and how they are managing their insurance. I'd like to look into the Affordable Care Act to see if there's that could be an option for our retired, possibly. I also would like to look into the possibility of us buying an insurance policy separate, or else should we pay retirees an amount of money for them to purchase their coverage. These are things we need to look into, I think, as options. So that's why I'd like to have this meeting to discuss those things, just see what's out there. So I hope you'll vote yes.
Dan Ash, Douglas County Clerk. I don't mean to get us off the rails, but I wanted to address it while we were still on this item, because it was brought up during this item. I just wanted to defend my friend, Commissioner Kavanaugh, and before I do so, I'm not questioning or anything Mr. Lorenz said, because I think what Mr. Lorenz said was true. But in regards to the surplus from the general fund last year, according to Merriam-Webster, a surplus is the amount that remains when the use or need is satisfied. Well, for our general fund budget last year, what remained was $5.3 million, so I don't believe Commissioner Kavanaugh was trying to be misleading or inaccurate when he stated that earlier. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
There is a motion and a second on the floor. Please vote.
I'd buy lunch for everybody who votes yes. No. Did I say that? I say that out loud. Yeah, I will.
Motion fails.
Oh, dang it. I'm taking names.
So we have the other motion and second. Right, to deal with that compromise.
If you wouldn't mind giving us 1 minute so we can type it in correctly.
No, you can have the time. What are you voting on now?
The 5%. This is just the retirees.
Yes. Commissioner Borgeson, can I interrupt you?
Yes.
This is what I would like it to say. So in the resolution, on the third whereas, there is a subparagraph, and that subparagraph reads as follows. Retirees under the age of 65 who desire to remain on the county's medical insurance plan shall pay 30% of the premium cost for single coverage and 40% of the premium cost for employee plus one and employee plus two or more coverage.
Okay.
And that follows what Joe.
That's correct.
Calculate. Okay.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Commissioner Boyle.
Shouldn't we be voting on tabling this for a year first?
I'm sorry?
Shouldn't we be voting on tabling the retiree issue first?
No, this is the there's a motion to on the compromise of the percentage increase on the retirees. So if this fails, then there would need to be a motion to table it.
Well, I think it ought to be tabled at first. And if that fails, then we do the vote on the percentage increase.
There's been no motion to table.
Well, I'll make a motion to table it then for a year.
Second.
I think it needs to happen that way. Right. Otherwise, we're approving something, and then we never, if we approve this, then we don't vote to table. I don't see how we do.
Right.
Because we're approving.
Right, but you just made the motion, so that goes in front of the motion that's
good.
On the floor.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Kavanaugh?
I'm going to support this motion. I supported the last motion. I think that the seat of the pants compromise, so-called, is a bad one, and I'll oppose that, too. We don't need to do this today. We don't need to do this to our employees. We don't need to do it for fiscal responsibility. And we don't need to do it because it's the right thing to do. It's not. It's the wrong thing to do. And people have brought up here that folks are going to be compelled to go out and work some more. And just to give you my philosophical background on this, prior to the enactment of the Social Security Act during the New Deal, 75% of Americans worked till they died. Worked till they died. This is a step in that direction. So we're going to take people who are retired, who made a deal with Douglas County, and we're going to put them back out in the job market because we can, for no good budget reason. I'm against that. I'm going to vote against that. We need to take a long look at that, and Commissioner Boyle has offered us the opportunity to do that. That's a responsible thing to do, and it's the right thing to do. Thanks.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. I'm hearing what an onerous impact this lump sum that was proposed is going to have on our retirees. And I appreciate the compromise that says we're only going to do a third of what we were planning on doing when we came into this meeting this morning as to what was proposed. That is a reasonable compromise. If we just lay this over for a year and next year the employees are going to say, don't raise it. We don't want it raised. And so we'll say, okay, we'll lay it over for a year. We have to be addressing this. To say there's no fiscal impact or that it's not important fiscally is just wrong. This is $250,000 of our budget was built on this. It's what Joe presented. We all acquiesced and said, looks like a good package. But then when it comes time to actually implement it, we get cold feet and don't want to do it. This is a reasonable compromise. It's only a third of what was proposed, and I think that we, I want to be great to all people. I'd love to give employees everything they want and pretend it doesn't cost anything. But it does. At the end of the day, the taxpayers have to be paying for this, and I think the compromise is a reasonable approach, and I intend to support it. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I don't agree. I think we really need to take a really hard look at it, look at possibly doing coverage stage changes and what options are out there through NACO and so forth. It isn't, to me, it isn't good because I think Matt mentioned that he's looking at if he retires, he's looking at something in excess of $3,000 a month. And what we're talking about here for an employee and a family who's retired, we're telling them what we just compromised on, that it would be $1,260 a year for insurance. Well, I mean, that's a huge bite out of someone's pension. That is really, I mean, what is that, close to a third, something like that. So it really needs to be looked at. We need to decide what we're going to do and look at options. That's what I think. So I hope you'll vote to table this. Give us a chance to come up with options.
There is a motion on the floor to table the item number 3 under the Human Resources agenda.
One more quick comment.
Commissioner Duda, that's fine. Commissioner Duda.
We need to be having that conversation regardless of how this vote goes, of how we're going to go forward in the future. How can we afford to keep providing what we want to provide, what they want to receive? Those conversations have to be ongoing and constant. Regardless of what we do today, the compromise is a small step in that direction, but it doesn't mean that that's the end of it. It's just one more step down this trail that we've got to go down anyway.
Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I don't agree. I think we ought to table it and then look at, rather than raising the premiums and then looking at it, I think that's backwards, with all due respect. Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers?
And Commissioner Boyle, I agree where you want to go to some degree, but the conversation you want to have, you can't have in the window right now. I don't think you can have in the window right now because of where the health enrollment piece is and everybody having to enroll. The point of trying to get with NACO, I think, would be a whole year's discussion, unless you're going to, I think the sentiment is not to do that. It's, you would have to have that whole year discussion to kind of get everybody in line for next year's enrollment piece, because I don't know if you can line all that up in a year. That's where my sentiment is on that.
Commissioner Boyle?
Thanks, Sam. It won't take that long at all. I was the NACO representative, and I participated when premiums were being raised by Blue Cross Blue Shield. We had about 30 people there down in Lincoln talking about it and so forth. So I know that I could get a hold of Larry Dix and talk to him about what you're providing, what are your retirees paying, that sort of stuff. It won't take a year. It'll probably take about 2 hours. So I just, it's information we need. It's just like Mr. Duda said, his sister retired and she's paying the full bill. Well, I don't know how that works, but I think we need more information. So it will not take a year by any means. I can, we can have the information awfully quick.
I confused the next insurance item because I conflated issues then. To your issue about the retiree piece.
I'm sorry, I can't.
I conflated issues because I'm assuming you were mixing that and all of the issues about looking at benefits and all that in one.
So
separating the insurance piece, I'm sure that probably will be a quick discussion because from my understanding, the conversations, at least that I've heard at the table over the last year and a half, no other county in the state is offering retiree insurance, so that's going to be a short discussion.
Fine. But we need to look at the coverage. We need to look at what NACO does. We need to look at what the city of Omaha, Lancaster County, state of Nebraska, all those things, and get a handle on what's going on and what's fair. We need to look at other options for our retirees. Should we be paying them cash to have them go buy it, coverage themselves? And if so, what's available for them? I just think we have a lot of things to look at that could be very viable options and save us money and treat the retirees well.
Commissioner Morgan.
No matter what happens today, none of us are going to feel good about what happens. And I think we should have discussions ongoing, not next year at budget time, but before then, to get some comparables and talk about what options are out there. So regardless of what happens, we're going to take, you know, I want to initiate with our staff, Diane, Joe, Patrick, the chairperson, all of us start to have some discussions. There will be open public meetings in 903, and we'll start working on that. It's usually a little quieter in December. Everyone has a lot of good feelings going on, and we'll make sure we have some meetings about that. Regardless of what happens, we're going to have to talk. Okay.
Okay. Motion to table. Please vote.
Mr. Borgeson, before there was already a motion on the floor by Commissioner Moore and Commissioner Duda for the 5% compromise.
The table supersedes that.
There we go. All right.
So this is the table.
Yes, the vote right now is for the table. Motion fails.
So now there's a motion for the 5%, or what Patrick stated in the resolution.
Give us one moment, please. Okay, thank you.
Just go ahead and try to get
it. Motion passes.
And Commissioner Boyle, I'll schedule a HR committee meeting with that, all those items that you listed on the agenda. Do we have time to publish? We won't have time to publish.
It's just, it's not going to be enough time.
Yeah. So the next week. You have to, it has to, no?
Well, tomorrow is.
Oh, it's Columbus Day.
You are talking about the 6th, which is Thursday.
Oh, the 6th.
Which is Thursday, and
you have to have 5 days.
You need to publish it, and then we need to have time to gather all information that you're requesting to gather, so we make sure. My understanding is that the decision has now been made on the retiree health insurance.
Yes.
So there's not a time crunch on that issue.
Right.
To have to do something on the 6th.
That's why I said I would schedule an HR committee meeting with all of those items that Commissioner Boyle wanted to look into as agenda items.
Okay, so when would you do that, Commissioner?
Next week is, Monday is a holiday, so.
Not for us.
We're closed Monday.
Oh,
it's
okay.
Columbus Day.
All right.
And so I will work with Karen to see what day next week works.
So next week is, the week of the 9th?
Well, you'll be gone, right?
Yeah, I'll be gone.
The week of the 10th, yeah. 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, and 14th.
We're not going to meet on the 10th, so it could be the 11th, 12th, 13th, or 14th, right?
Right.
Okay, well,
and
I'll just have to accept that. I don't think it's necessary to go that long, but that's fine.
We have to publish it, though.
I think you can publish a lot quicker. So anyway, that's just the way it is. This is such a bureaucracy, it makes me insane.
Commissioner Rogers, it's not
I just
rule.
Think,
I know.
You know, Commissioner Boyle, I think that's just, I just want to know, I think that's the first meeting. I think if Commissioner Borgeson's, if you're asking them to go down that route, I think it's a series of meetings. It's not just this.
It's just one.
You're going to have to get a feel for, you know, AI is going to come in, and then you're going to have to get a feel to ask some other people get in and get a feel for this market and the rates, because I guarantee you, depending on what happens with this election, it's going to be more volatile. And next year is going to seem like chump change compared to this discussion, depending on what happens. So I just think we're looking, if we're really trying to dig in this, we're looking for a series of meetings, like quarterly or every other month. So I just, I mean,
I don't care. Let's do it till next year. No, if that's the way you want to operate, I think it's unnecessary. But okay.
No, I'm not saying I want to, and I just put it what it is, because the discussion that we just had with the employees.
Let me just tell you, you're wrong.
Okay.
That's fine. I accept that, and I'm telling you, you're wrong.
I know. Okay. That's the end of it.
All right. Everybody's that's the end of wrong. Everybody's wrong. How's that? Okay. Next
wrong.
Item is resolution increasing the county's medical insurance premium by 9% effective January 1, 2017. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Motion by Duda, seconded by Rogers. Please vote.
Where's Kavanaugh?
I don't know.
Where do you go?
He left.
Oh, boy.
We can wait.
Commissioner Borgerson, as you're voting on that, please note that the chart showing the premiums that's attached to that will be amended because of the change you made with the retirees. So those numbers aren't exactly right now for the retirees.
Right.
Well, the motion did pass.
Okay. Is there a need for executive session? No need for executive session. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved. Second.
Please vote.